Hello and welcome to this talk titled DFTK, a Julian approach for simulating electrons in solids. I'm Michael Herbst and today I'm going to talk about joint work that I did with Antoine Levitt and Eric Canthes. We are all three located at the CERMIX lab at Ecole des Ponts in Paris. It's an applied math lab, but my background, for example, is that I'm a chemist. So the direction into which this is really going is like interdisciplinary software development aided by using Julia, which is aimed really at combining communities and bringing together people. And with this spirit, I'm actually really happy that I'm able to talk to you on the JuliaCon, which again is not neither chemistry nor mathematics. And I'm really happy to be given the chance by the organizers to present to you about what we did in the recent recent year or so. And before really going a bit into the challenges that we wish to address with DFTK and our Julia code, I'm going to give you a little bit of background on density functional theory, just that you get an idea of the challenges and the problems of the subject. So density functional theory. The whole idea of density functional theory and electronic structure theory as a whole is to provide a physical description of electrons. And you might really ask why I care about electrons. Well, from my personal point of view, the funny thing about them is that they are quite strange beasts because electrons glue things together. I mean, you can easily find out about that if you try to bite into a piece of steel. It's not that fun. It really, the electrons want to keep together. But at the same time, electrons also keep things apart. So, for example, the reason that my laptop's not falling through my table right here is because just electrons repel each other. So it's this ambivalence which makes personally electrons interesting. But then also on the broader scale, people in practice are super interested in them because, for example, the properties of materials or semiconductors, or also the properties of chemicals which are used for pharmaceutical industries, building up drugs and all these sort of things. A lot of these properties have to do with electrons and the behavior of electrons in matter. So being able to describe them properly and accurately is really for broader interest than just understanding the bizarreness. It's really also for making cash and for understanding how the world works to some extent, how chemistry works. So you might ask, I'm talking about chemistry, I'm talking about labs, aren't experiments good enough? Well, turns out experiments are of course expensive. You know, computers are much cheaper than people time, for example. But also there's a problem with interpretation because just one drop of water is a huge number of particles. So this 1.7 times 10 to the 21 I'm quoting here. And if you do an experiment, if you look at an experimental result, it's just an average. And averages are not that easy to interpret from time to time. It's not always easy to make links to physical laws and therefore to be able to really improve on physical laws. So in electronic structure theory, it's really about cooperative research with experimental people and theoretical developments to kind of bring together what we know and extrapolate to what we don't know. And nowadays, for this reason, it's actually standard practice in industry and research, up to the point that even in organic chemistry, for example, papers are usually not accepted if you don't have calculation results which back some of your statements. So it's really a joint project very often. Between experimentalists and theoreticians. So, electronic structure theory, modeling electrons. What we really want is we want to understand electronic properties. So properties such as how does matter conduct electrical power? How is the, for example, the activity of a semiconductor when I shine light on it, these sort of things. And for understanding these things, we need to construct physical models, obviously, and then validate and interpret experiment. And just to sketch a little bit the approach, electrons are really small and quite light, and therefore they're the regime of quantum mechanics. And in quantum mechanics, describing a system is typically done by a Hamiltonian, that's a differential operator. And in order to really find the most important aspect of a system, that boils down to finding the so-called ground state, which has the lowest energy. So lowest energy basically means minimization problem. And in practice, what you really essentially do is you solve this minimization problem I sketch here. So where you basically sandwich this ground state wave function as a function really between the sandwich the Hamiltonian between two of these wave functions and then solve this multidimensional integral and minimize over it. And for example, if you want to look at properties such as conductivity or photoactivity, it's roughly speaking just taking derivatives of such an energy. So really this idea of the minimization problem is the key aspect to understand what is going on. And density functional theory basically answers the question of how to compute such a thing. Because the problem is that in practice, this integral is pretty large. Like I said, it's this integral r to the 3n. Now, what is n? Well, already for a really small system, like just a silicon unit cell, so the principal part of a silicon crystal, is two silicon atoms, and their n is 28. So the dimensionality of this integral is 84. And if I just take two quadrature points along each dimension, I get the humongous number of 10 to the 25 quadrature points. So if I want to be finished with just one integral in 1 year, that means I actually need 1.5 attoseconds per quadrature point. So doing a minimization then, of course, one needs to do multiple times this integral, so it gets really, really expensive up to the point where it's just not practical. So what people do is approximations. One of them is density functional theory. What you do there is you construct an effective one particle model. So you make some approximations, I'm waving my hands here, of course, and then by making these approximations, you're able to set effectively n to 1. A few disadvantages here, of course, it's an approximation, and it turns out that in many cases you need to adapt the model slightly depending on the context. So it's not universal anymore if you want. It's pretty universal, it's pretty ab initio still, but still some tweaking needs to be done. Other problem here is that it's like, whereas the original minimization is really nice and convex, the DFT minimization is non-convex and it's non-linear. I'll show that in a second a bit more in detail. And also, well, what we also do is a second trick. When we actually discretize this whole problem, we don't just use two quadrature points randomly like a grid or something. We actually use a slightly more complicated discretization basis, which builds known physics into the problem. All right, now the structure of DFT. What you really need to solve in DFT are these complicated equations. I don't really want to discuss them in detail. The point is that this is essentially defining the stationary point of the minimization. And what you do here is you need to construct this F, this operator, actually the Cohn-Chaim operator. And in order to construct it, you need to know the rho, the density. That's the density in density functional theory. However, in order to construct the density, you need to know the eigenfunctions of the operator. So that's essentially you have two equations and you need to solve them together, but each depends on the other. So it's kind of a bit of a circular thing. So in practice, what you need to do is you need to essentially start at the density, build the operator, diagonalize this to get these new little phis, take the new little phis, build the next density and hope that you're a step closer. And then you're kind of reiterating and hopefully you're converging. But I mean, it's obviously more complicated than I say here, but you get the idea. So it's really not such a simple problem. And that brings me to DFTK, essentially our version to try and tackle this problem. We're not the only people. I mean, DFT has been around for, I don't know, 70, 80 years or something. So it's a reasonably old theory. And I mean, because of its usefulness, it's kind of obvious that there are people who are starting or have started to do it. And there are plenty of codes. And many of these codes really represent hundreds of man-year of coding work, if you think about it. I mean, typically they have a million lines of code or beyond. So it's really huge codes. So you might ask really, why do we even bother with this DFTK? Why do we start from scratch? And one primary motivation for us was this really also our interdisciplinary background, because I'm working with mathematicians, and when mathematicians look at such problems, what they want to do is they want to look at simple toy problems, which are not always physically relevant, but where you can understand the mathematical structure. So they really look at these details. On the other hand, the scientist doesn't really want to focus on these details. He wants to focus on the science, right? And usually doesn't care that much about like how algorithms work and the numerics, how good it converges. So the stuff that the mathematicians care about. But then on the other hand, you've also high performance people who really want to take such a DFT code and optimize it to everything that you can get from the hardware. So they again have the demands to really look into the code and tune everything that can be tuned. And then you have the practitioner who doesn't really care about all these things, just wants to run the calculation, get an answer, and, you know, get on with his research and get on with his science. And therefore, for them, it's really the reliability, the high-level interface. Whereas, for example, mathematicians really look into the details, so they need low-level. And so in practice, what's really the obstacle here is that because of the difficulty of the DFT problem, the codes are complex. And because people typically only have a particular idea, typically have a very particular idea how to do things, algorithms, workflows, and all these things are really hard-coded. Up to the point that also hardware optimizations are hard-coded. And for example, if you want to do a GPU code, you need to do a hard fork and start from scratch. Well, not from scratch, but you need a hard fork and you have two different codes all of a sudden. And that makes the codes pretty huge. And additionally, the problem from the practitioner's point of view, for example, is that the input syntax is far from standard. So it's not like it's a really standardized API, and it's more like a particular input file that is specific only to this code and that you really need to learn before you can even able to do a calculation. Mm-hmm. And if you especially want to look at complicated difficult aspects of difficult systems, for example, you often need hand tuning. So you need to tune, but sometimes not everything is tunable. So it's always a bit of a dodgy thing. And in the end, for example, it always also boils down to questions of this two language problem, because somewhere you have to cut between the things you have deep inside your Fortran or C++ code and the things you expose, for example, to Python. But wherever you cut for all these four people, it's not always great for all of them. Okay, so DFTK is kind of a slightly different approach using Julia. And where are we now? We have now, I think, 14 or 15 months of development, around 5,000 lines. It's pretty much a pure Julia code. We have some dependencies towards Python and C to set up and do some standard stuff. But really, most of the infrastructure is actually in Julia. And we already get towards a pretty sizable feature set. So we have multi-level threading. We are able to treat 1D, 2D, 3D systems. The models you can completely compose as you want. So it's not just DFT. It's also like toy problems as the mathematicians need it. But it's also slightly related problems to DFT if you want. We are able to, for example, treat up to 500 electrons. And that's possible just because we actually already have a performance between a factor of 2 to the established codes. And we for example also focus on integrating with Python modules that are already available from the material science community, and by kind of making this connection between toy problems, between composing new scientific models and looking into what people already use in practice. The idea is to create this platform for multidisciplinary research. And we have excessive documentation and examples which can help you to get started in case you're interested. Now, 14 months and 5,000 lines of code for something such as DFT is actually challenging. Well, I can tell you that from my experience. And basically, the only way we really manage is because from the Julia community, there is already a pretty awesome set of packages around in the ecosystem. So just to give you an idea, when we started, we just looked what was around and we found that, for example, Fourier transforms is there at FFTW. Nonlinear solvers for this nonlinear SCF problem, we can just use Optim, NLSolve, and so on and so forth. So a lot of building blocks for the things we required were just there. We could just use it. And actually, I really have to say thanks at this point, because I don't think we would have been able to manage within the time and also within the shortness of the code if all of this ecosystem has not been around. Okay, so that brings me to tackling a few challenges in DFT. What do we want to do with DFTK? First of all, what's really an issue in practice is that the barrier for getting going with research is quite high. I mean, that is talking money, of course, because actually some of these codes I was mentioning earlier, they require licenses that can go up to something like 5,000 euros per license, which is, well, not all of them, some are open source, but this is of course an issue in practice. Also, when people really want to get going, they don't want to learn an obscure API with a strange input file format. I mean, in practice, you do for many of these codes. So, the 3 years of a PhD, the first few months is just learning how to use the tools. But people should do science. They shouldn't learn how to do the tools, of course. And so what we really wanted is to have a development platform also which doesn't suffer for things like scarce tests, scarce comments and documentation, which is actually a problem in practice. And if you couple this with the fact that usually it's like a million lines of code or more, which are completely non-uniform or formatted or anything, and the people who develop the code, namely former PhD students, are typically left, it's not that easy to get going and get started with the code. So for DFTK, therefore, we really wanted to keep the code as small as possible, as visible as possible. We wanted to have the code to be resembling the equations that you find in the standard publications or books as much as possible. We are actually referencing them in comments in many cases to make it easy to find out how we oriented our structure. And also one key design goal was really to get the math and the physics separate and in line. So the structure of DFTK really resembles very closely the structure of DFT from a mathematical point of view. And it really allows you to see the structure of the math inside the code. And of course, Julia is a choice also from the point of view that it's great learning resources and it's for free. I mean, people can just download it. And I mean, I remember a few years ago when I started learning Julia, I was amazed how simple it was to just find great tutorials, great resources online. And just to kind of emphasize on this, a few example projects that we've done recently. One master student and has not really known anything about DFT or Julia, but still after like a really short master project, 6 months, 8 months, he was able to actually publish. So he managed to do new science in DFTK, in this case on analysis of SCF software, of SCF algorithms. Another example, we had a short 8-week research project from some students, which were toying a bit with GPUs in DFTK, not getting towards DFT, I should say, but nevertheless, I mean, in 8 weeks, without knowing Julia or the theory, they managed to do something productive on GPUs. Another example is a recent paper we published, where it literally took us 10 weeks from having the idea to publishing everything. And I mean, I was surprised myself how quickly it was in the end. Now, another big thing that's kind of starting to come up in the community is a problem, is an aspect called high throughput screening. So the idea is, when you're designing a new material, when you're getting started with a material which should have certain properties, you're actually starting by making mass calculations. So you define certain classifiers, which are usually not that easy to describe, like, for example, band gap excitation energies, just terms, I mean, basically objects that you can compute from DFT, which are, however, not so easy. And you are looking really at a huge number of candidates, like in this case, maybe 10,000, 20,000 candidates. You're trying to narrow them down to something like 10 that you then investigate in detail. Problem here is you really need tunable accuracy versus speed, right? I mean, in the beginning, when you look at 10,000 candidates, you want calculations to be as fast as possible, but accuracy is not so important. But in the end, I said these classifiers are difficult to model. There you really want the accuracy to be able to get the 10 compounds that best fit your needs. And therefore, ideally, what you would like to have is you would have like one accuracy parameter that kind of tunes everything together in line. Practice, that's not the case, unfortunately. In practice, it's more like that tens and of parameters in that order that you really need to tune together to get there. I mean, the defaults are round, but they're not always good, right? And problem is, on top of all of this, usually when you choose the parameters not ideal, or basically if the parameter defaults are not chosen ideal for your problem, it can happen that from time to time the SCF just breaks down. So the whole thing just goes nowhere, and numerically you have to stop it. And that's okay if you're looking at 10 calculations, for example, 10 compounds. But if you're looking at tens of thousands, something breaking down just shouldn't happen. And of course, again, when I'm talking about tens of thousands of compounds, I'm also talking about being able to exploit what hardware is around. I'm talking about being able to interface to data science tools and scriptability and all of that. And existing codes are really, they're quite clunky. So the API typically is designed quite a priori, which means what people expose, they expose. What they don't, you have basically no luck. And certain decisions about how to attack the problem and how to model it are really hard-coded. So floating point type is a typical example. It's really difficult to change that in existing codes. and the freedom to, for example, tweak certain algorithms in directions to make them more reliable is basically, it's not a lot, let's say. And for GPUs, I said this before, you actually need to usually, what's done in practice, you actually hard fork the code as it is adapted, and then you have a GPU and a CPU version. And yeah, these sort of issues were really the long-term driving force between DFDK, where we try to make things different. To give you maybe one example about this, and also which really goes into the line of this high-performance throughput modeling, is a posteriori error estimates. So when you are, for example, doing a calculation, it would be really nice to have a rigorous mathematical bound to tell you how far away are you from the exact solution. And mathematically, this is exactly what a posteriori error estimates are for. It is giving you the answer for, has the target accuracy that I want, that I care about, been reached? So in line with this high-throughput screening, there are multiple sources of errors in DFT, right? I mean, they're all coupled to parameters that you have to choose, like discretization error means how big is my basis, algorithm error, how tightly do I converge, for example, arithmetic error, which floating point type do I use? So all these questions, model error, which DFT model do I use, for example, all these questions you choose when you're running the calculation, and ideally you want to choose them in line, that the error you make at each step is basically roughly the same. Because then if you are able to kind of automatically tune that and balance the error, you can do exactly what I sketched before. You have this one accuracy parameter that at the same time lowers in line all the errors that are around. You do not more work than necessary in any of these errors. And mathematically what you can do or how you can do that is really deriving a posteriori error estimates, a posteriori bounds on these individual errors. For DFT, the full picture is far from understood. I mean, you really are not there yet. So DFT, you can't do at that level. But what you can do is you can do reduced models. And in DFTK, we have been able to look at really simple models and do exactly that. And the idea would be to take DFTK and take these things and step by step expand all the way up to full DFT. Many things are not clear. For example, many ingredients, like some certain integrals that you might need to compute, certain derivatives and so on and so forth. So you really need an accessible toolbox for doing experimentation, for playing around and for basically constructing your numerical linear algebra as you go along. And for things like the arithmetic error, for example, you need unusual floating point types, like for example, interval arithmetic or elevated precision to make some estimates to get going. And this is you need really arbitrary precision floating point types. And for that reason, basically in DFTK, the model is completely customizable. You can throw out terms that you don't understand mathematically and start from where you have the full understanding, add them back in step by step over the sequence as you make further mathematical progress. And you, for example, have exactly this floating point, this arbitrary floating point support. And using the Julia ecosystem, things like, you know, playing around with new integrals using numerical quadrature or playing around with automatic differentiation to get some derivatives. It's really giving you this toolbox to do rapid prototyping in numerical linear algebra that you need in order to design such a posteriori error estimates that are reliable and useful, actually. Yeah, and in fact, we have done that. So that was the paper I just mentioned where we managed to get something done in 10 weeks. That's a really reduced model where we managed to, you see, put these tiny little error bars, which are rigorously derived mathematical errors for this span structure calculation in this case, using a non-self-consistent model and using Julia packages interval arithmetic and double floats. Another thing I don't want to talk about because of the sake of time, another thing we did is improving on SCF algorithms, where similarly you need to first build toy problems and then expand slowly and be able to do this in one code up to the point of really running a full calculation. Now, what DFTK, what I just told you, is it's closely integrated in the Julia ecosystem. It's able to mix and match. You're able to mix and match and build new algorithms, test them on toy problems, rapidly prototype on reduced models, and then finally scale them up really to the full scale of 500 electrons and test on realistic applications. In the future, what we want to do is we want to tackle more challenging systems, things like spin, for example. We want to really do the full error estimates for DFT, go towards this black boxed approach that I was talking before for high performance computing, one accuracy parameter to really tune everything in line. That means things like mixed precision as well, multiple grid methods, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, eventually go beyond DFT. It's an approximation I set, so there are models to go beyond. And also look at things as really full GPU integration. And that brings me to acknowledging my co-authors, other people that have contributed to DFTK, and of course, all the great developers of Julia and the packages we use every day, and my funding from my university and the ESC grant. That brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to your questions.